Order, order. The National Assembly is in session. Item one, questions to the First Minister. Question one, Jeff Cuthbert.
Dear Clywydd, will the First Minister make a statement on the potential benefits of the South Wales Metro?
Yes, I provided members with a full update on the potential benefits of the Metro last week after I'd formally launched a campaign to raise public awareness of the project at Pontypridd Station.
Thank you for that response, First Minister. I've no doubt that the South Wales Metro would be of great benefit to my constituents, not least because of the quicker and more regular services back and forth to Cardiff and other major centres of employment, west-east as well as north-south, and together with electrification of the Rumney Valley line, it'll improve the quality of journeys. However, First Minister, would you agree with me that another important aspect of a successful metro network will be to make house building on brownfield sites in the Heads of the Valleys region more attractive to private developers, thereby reducing the constant and ever-growing pressure to build new estates on greenfield sites in areas such as the Caerphilly Basin?
Yes, I do, because in the latter stages of the Metro project, there is scope for constructing light rail links into new estates, making them easier in terms of access to the rest of the network and in terms of access to jobs. It's right to say that where the infrastructure is right, then of course it becomes far more attractive to develop in areas that before that infrastructure is in place are seen as unattractive.
William Graham.
Presiding Officer. Well, the First Minister agree with me. Not only will the Metro scheme build on existing and future economic development for the area, but will also act as an important stimulus to social cohesion.
Yes, I do, as I've said before. This is not a question of putting in place a transport system that just brings people to Cardiff to work, but connects communities with the capital city so that investment can flow away from the capital city as well. I see it very much as a two-way process.
Julie Morgan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's very welcome, the support for the Metro. How much does the further development of the Metro concept depend on agreement being made about Cardiff and the capital city deal?
Well, obviously, it's an important part of the city deal. We have made our commitment. Local government has made its commitment. Now, of course, we wait to see the progress of negotiations between local government, whose bid it is, and the UK government.
Lindsay Whittle.
First Minister, what assurances can you give that the Metro will be focused on greater improvement in connection with the valleys and other cities within the region, and not just on relieving congestion in Cardiff? I appreciate that this city is becoming more and more congested. One Coca-Cola lorry brought it to a halt last week. Well, if this is a regional strategy, we need to make sure that we better connect with other regional centres too.
Yes, I can't promise that in the plans for the Metro that we have made provision for such unlikely events as a Coca-Cola lorry arriving on spec without any notice at all, but unfortunately there are many who would have been inconvenienced by it who may not have been positively influenced by the message it was carrying, if I can put it that way. As part of the Metro project, of course, we are looking at cross-valley links as well, particularly, though not exclusively, through bus rapid transit, because we recognise that the Metro system, in order to be cohesive, has to have cross-valley links as part of it, not simply links that come down to Cardiff.
Lynette Parrott.
First Minister, clearly the Metro is a key driver of change for that city deal, and it's vital that the city deal and the Metro must work together strategically if we're going to derive the maximum benefits. But will the Welsh Government in the long term retain control of the Metro project, or will it be handed over to the control of the local authorities within the city region as their own governance structures progress and city deal funding is discussed?
No, the Metro itself will be organised so that there is one organisation that runs the Metro. It's a Welsh Government project, and certainly it's our intention that we retain influence and control over that project, but we want to work with local authority partners as well. In time, that model may change. What's absolutely crucial is that there is one body in place that runs the Metro as a network.
Question Dye.
Question two, Alan Fred Jones. Thank you very much. Will the First Minister make a statement on the devolution of business rates? Well, the devolution of business rates provides an important opportunity to focus on developing the right regime for Wales. Thank you very much. Well, the devolution of non-domestic rates is to be welcome, of course, although as far as I know, we don't have the right to vary the way in which that tax is levied, but it Another concern is the methodology of adapting the block grant, and the formula favoured by the Treasury will disadvantage Wales. So what pressure has the government placed on the Treasury to ensure fairness for Wales, and what meetings have taken place to discuss this? The member is entirely correct on the change that's taken place. It's not something that benefits Wales. The minister has raised our concerns about this change to the Barnett formula with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury, and we continue to make the Welsh Government's case, and we'll continue to do so over the next few weeks.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. First Minister, what progress is being made to ensure that the no detriment principle is followed on the devolution of NNDR and that the formula does not produce a Barnett-type squeeze?
Well, building on the answer I gave to the member for Arvon, we are concerned that the new approach is inconsistent with the principles that should be applied when considering the interaction between the block grant and devolved taxes. A recent paper from the Institute for Fiscal Studies and the University of Stirling concluded that this type of approach that's being adopted to block grant adjustments fails the principle that there should be no detriment from the decision to devolve the tax, and that is why we will keep on pressing the UK government to realise that this is not an appropriate way to conduct affairs with regard to the formula itself.
Nick Ramsey.
First Minister, the full devolution of business rates to the Welsh Government does indeed provide an opportunity to better develop a supporting regime for businesses within Wales. Welsh Conservatives have long called for business rates to be reduced and for business rates up to £12,000 to be removed. Will you look again at our policy and look at a way to develop the regime within Wales so that businesses are better supported?
Small business rate relief scheme, of course, has been successful. But of course, what he must explain is how the loss of revenue will be made up in terms of the Welsh budget. We know that where we look to reduce revenue, then there is a concomitant reduction in spending as well. We believe the spending that the current scheme has been very successful, and certainly I'm sure all parties will be examining the opportunities that the business rate relief that business rates offer in terms of their offers to the people of Wales in May.
Peter Black.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. First Minister, you know that in England there are a number of innovations being experimented on around business rates, such as tax increment financing, giving local authorities the power to keep some of the business rates which they might be able to gain if they attracted additional investment into their area. Is the Welsh Government looking to do similar things in Wales, and if so, when?
Well, this has to be approached with great caution, because it is possible for local authorities to lose that substantially if the balance is not right between what they raise and their block grant. We know that if local authorities, if business rates were completely self-contained within local authorities, 17 local authorities in Wales would lose out as a result, and some would benefit handsomely. That much is true, but there will be an enormous change. We're always keen to look at ways to incentivise local authorities to be able to attract business into their communities, but it is important to ensure that local authorities don't lose out as a result of any changes.
I now call the party leaders to question the First Minister, starting this week with the Leader of the Opposition, Andrew R.T. Davis.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. First Minister, it's Budget Day today. That gives us the opportunity to reflect on maybe some of the budget decisions you've made in this Assembly term, because obviously today is the last draft budget statement that this current government will make. In the early years of this Assembly, obviously the government put forward budgets that have devastating cuts to the NHS budget, especially year one and year two. In year one, for example, £225 million was taken out of the NHS budget. Do you now regret those decisions that so savagely took away resources from the Welsh NHS?
Clear. There's a 0.6% increase in real terms to the Welsh NHS budget, despite the fact there's been a 10% decrease in the Welsh budget. That shows the priority we give to the Welsh NHS, and we're proud of the fact that today there will be a substantial increase, reflecting, of course, Wales's position as being ahead of England in the amount we spend per head on health.
It's quite remarkable that you're not really defending the positions that you did take in the early part of this Assembly, because you clearly know they were so wrong for the NHS here in Wales. And in particular, when you look at yesterday's report from the Royal College of Surgeons, the state of surgery in Wales, which show that one in seven people are on a waiting list in Wales, 450,000 people are on a waiting list in Wales. That's nearly double the number that are, as a percentage, are on a waiting list in England. We also know that the 26 wait is up by 70% since 2000.
2011. Wales has the lowest number of critical care beds across Europe, not the UK, across Europe. And when you look at that report, nearly all these indicators started to go the wrong way in 2013, the year after your first two budgets that delivered such devastating cuts to the Welsh NHS. How are you actually going to address some of these damning statistics over your management and your government's failure to address the shortfalls in the Welsh NHS?
He fails to recognise the inherent weakness in his argument. If he claims that there have been record cuts in the Welsh NHS, then the cuts in England must have been even worse under his party, under his government. We have seen an increase in Welsh NHS spending over 5 years. We have seen a real terms increase. We have done that despite the fact that we've seen a real terms decrease of 10% from his government in London. And we are today putting more money into the Welsh NHS. Well, he wants to remove £250 million from the Welsh NHS, so what he's proposing for taxes. And he has to show that if he wishes to remove money out of the Welsh budget, where he is going to make those cuts. Perhaps he can be honest with the people of Wales and tell us.
No apology, no remorse for what you've done to the NHS here in Wales in the early years of your tenure as First Minister in this Assembly. Those figures aren't Conservative figures that I quoted to you in my second question. They are the figures put forward by the Royal College of Surgeons that paint a damning picture of what you have presided over in the Welsh NHS. And time again, you keep talking that there's more money spent on patients in Wales than there is in England. That clearly is not the case. If you take the Nuffield figures, we also know that for the adjusted age and reflecting our increasing aged population, £50 per person less is spent on health in Wales per person. That is a fact, First Minister.
The Treasury
you know
wrong.
That, and you know that over the term of this Assembly, you have taken £1 billion out of the NHS here in Wales. Will you not show now some remorse for those devastating decisions that have led to such astronomical waiting times here in Wales?
The figures that I quoted are his government's figures from the Treasury.
No apology.
Was he saying that the Treasury is misleading the people of Britain? The reality is the PESA figures the Treasury produced show that we spend more on health per head in Wales than England does. His party's figures, not my all of the Treasury, wrong. And again, he doesn't give us an answer, does he, in terms of the £250 million cut that he wants to impose on the Welsh budget. He doesn't say what he's going to do about social care, because older people in England are being dumped by the UK government. We see delayed transfers of care going through the roof in England as people are stuck in hospital. We see that social care in England is being abandoned by the UK government. We see it's being thrown at local authorities. We in Wales will never be in a position where we leave our old people, our older people, vulnerable in the way that the Tories are doing in England. We will continue to spend more per head on health in Wales than in England. We will continue to spend far more on social care in Wales than the Tories do in England. It just goes to show you can't trust the Welsh NHS with the Tories.
Order. Let's all calm down. I've got to go. Now the Leader of Plaid Cymru, Leanne Wood.
Diolch. I'd like to start by saying a big welcome to the pupils of my former primary school who are with us in the public gallery today, the children of Penygraig Juniors, and a big well done to them on an excellent Estyn report as well. First Minister, the UK Government's Statement of Funding Policy, published at the time of the Comprehensive Spending Review, states that the direct Barnett consequential for Wales from the HS2 project is 0%. The corresponding figure for Scotland and for Northern Ireland is 100% Barnett consequential. Will you confirm that that is the case?
The consequential from HS2 is £755 million for Wales.
First Minister, you are now deliberately confusing two different figures. Wales will see an increased consequential as a result of an overall increase in the UK Department for Transport's budget. That's overall an overall increase in the transport budget. But Wales is missing out on a much more significant increase because, as the Treasury confirms, Wales will not receive a direct consequential from the HS2 project. First Minister, why are you taking the Tory line on this? And why are you content that Wales will miss out on millions of pounds again?
Well, just to explain the way this was done, The HS2 funding was put into the departmental funding line, the DEL of the Department for Transport, which is why we get a consequential. We would not have had a consequential if there'd been a separate DEL, as they tried to do with the Olympics. But because the funding is going into the Department for Transport budget, we then get a consequential. So we have had a consequential as a result of HS2 of £755 million.
That does not explain why Scotland and Northern Ireland are in a different position. Now, the delivery body for HS2 is HS2 Limited and not Network Rail. Unlike Network Rail, HS2 Limited is not devolved to either Scotland or to Northern Ireland. So why is the UK government singling out Wales for disadvantage? And why are you, as Wales's First Minister, quite happy for that to happen? Now, First Minister, Plaid Cymru warned you a year ago on this. Did you listen to us? No, you did not. Did you act when we spoke out a year ago? No, you did not. Don't the people of Wales deserve better than a passive First Minister?
What the people of Wales deserve is to be told things as they are. And the reality is that as a result of the representations we made to UK government, the HS2 funding was placed in the DEL of the Department for Transport, and as a result, we've had a consequential. If there'd been a separate DEL, we'd have had nothing at all. And that is the point. We have had a consequential of £755 million over the course of 5 years because of increased UK Department for Budget for Transport budget as a result of HS2. We have had a consequential because of HS2.
Order. Order. I'm sure we want to show to the young people that are visiting us, all sides of the chamber, that we listen calmly to both the questions and the answers. Now the leader of the Welsh Liberal Democrats, Kirsty Williams.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. First Minister, this afternoon I eagerly anticipate budget proposals to increase the Welsh Liberal Democrats' key schools policy of pupil premium to £1,150 per pupil. Last week, your government's evaluation report confirmed that the policy has resulted in significant improvements in literacy, numeracy, behaviour, confidence and self-esteem for our most disadvantaged pupils. What additional improvements do you expect to see for pupils in Welsh schools as a result of Welsh Liberal Democrats' decision to prioritise school funding in budget negotiations?
Well, the Pupil Deprivation Grant, of course, is what the Liberal Democrats brought to the table. Increasing school funding was a manifesto commitment made by my party. I'm not going to prejudge what the Minister is about to say in her draft budget statement, but of course we're aware of the agreement that was reached between the parties with regard to the budget.
Having persuaded you of the merits of one of our policies, I invite you to consider another, First Minister. Parents want teachers to have the time to properly to devote to their children. Evidence suggests, and Estyn has told us, that children learn better in smaller class sizes. Isn't it time to adopt the Welsh Liberal Democrat policy to cap class sizes at 25 pupils?
Well, that's something I'm sure that she can put forward in May. We have made sure that class sizes have been reducing over the years. We've improved standards in Welsh schools. We're seeing that. Best ever GCSE results that we've ever had. We're building schools, and that's not happening in England. There are no schools being built in England, nor are they being refurbished to the extent that they are in Wales. And we know that we spend 4% per head more on education in Wales than the Tory government does in England.
But the reality is, here in Wales, the number of children that are being taught in classes of 30 and over is increasing. And there has been a loss of 775 teachers since 2010. In 5 years, we've lost one teacher for every two pupils that have left the school system. What measures will your government take to stem the loss of teachers and the increases in class sizes?
Well, there's £106 million more in the education budget than there would have been if the pledge that we put in place in 2011 had not been carried through. That means there are more teachers in Welsh schools. It means there are more schools being built. It means we're seeing standards increase. Ultimately, of course, it's for local authorities and for schools to decide into the numbers that they employ. But bear in mind, of course, that if we're talking about teacher numbers, that the Tory plans for cuts in tax would mean 5,000 fewer teachers in Welsh schools. That's what it amounts to. It would mean 10,000 nurse salaries that wouldn't be paid. Again, we have a situation where a gimmick is presented to the Welsh electorate and deep cuts in education being proposed by the Tories.
Question three, Kirsty Williams.
Will the First Minister make a statement on the impact of fee levels for residential care on the viability of the sector?
Yes, local authorities have responsibility for working with providers and negotiating fee levels to ensure the sustainable provision of residential care to meet the needs of people in their local area.
First Minister, you will be aware that many people providing residential care are doing so on the margins of sustainable viability. Now, the proposals by the Westminster Government to increase a so-called living wage, and whilst nobody would argue that those working in the care sector deserve to be paid decently, without a corresponding rise in fee levels from local authorities who place residents in residential care sectors, some of those care beds could be lost. What is your government doing to analyse the situation and to work with local authorities to ensure the fee levels they're paying to residential care are adequate?
The Leader of the Liberal Democrats is absolutely right, because these are representations that have been made to me. The UK government has introduced the National Living Wage, which she and I would both very much welcome, but the cost of it is being borne by businesses and ultimately possibly by local authorities, but not by the UK government. It's another example, we saw it again in the CSR last week, where there's an abdication of financial responsibility by the UK government when it comes to social care, so they can blame other people when things go wrong. I can say that the National Commissioning Board is undertaking a detailed market analysis of the care home market across Wales. That analysis will encompass fee levels paid by health boards and local authorities and will capture information on third-party payments. It will also provide information on the balance between demand and supply for services, and that will help, of course, in terms of understanding the challenges that have been placed on the care sector by the UK government.
I'll tell you, say.
Yeah.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. First Minister, the care sector is facing a number of challenges in the coming decades. With an ageing population and budget constraints, do you agree that we need to look for innovative solutions? Welsh Conservatives believe that part of the solution is to keep people in their own home for longer, and keeping capacity in residential care for those with complex care needs. What is your government doing to support and enable older people to remain in their own homes?
Well, I mean, the member seems to suggest that we should have residential care for those who are the most infirm and nothing for anyone else. They should be at home. That clearly can't be right, with extra care facilities, particularly in terms of the facilities that they provide. What we will not do is do what his party have done in England and say, if you want more social care, then put 2% in the council tax. What that means, of course, is that those authorities who have the lowest council tax base and probably the greatest demand will find themselves caught twice in a double trap. More affluent areas will be able to afford social care, and poorer areas will not. That just sums up the attitude of the Tories in one sentence.
Question 4, Gwyn Price.
Thank you, Deputy Clywed. Will the First Minister make a statement on the initiative the Welsh Government had introduced to support entrepreneurs in Wales?
Yes, as a government, we are committed to providing the best environment possible to support entrepreneurs to start and grow their businesses in Wales.
Well, thank you for that answer. First Minister, the latest figures reveal a number of business enterprises operated in Wales has grown by more than 10% under the current Welsh Government. What can the Welsh Government do to build on this dynamic success?
Well, as a government, we have delivered wide-ranging actions to support job creation and to improve the business environment across Wales. We've placed jobs, growth and tackling poverty at the heart of our programme for government, with a clear alignment between these. And we can see that the latest data shows there are now 231,110 businesses in Wales compared to 207,740 in 2011. And we've seen an increase in employment as well within those businesses.
Paul Davies.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. First Minister, one way of supporting entrepreneurs is to strengthen the skills foundation and to give young people the chance to develop the skills that are relevant to the rural, to the local area. This would assist in keeping young entrepreneurs in areas such as Pembrokeshire. Now, many reports have suggested that more could be done in areas such as Pembrokeshire at the school and college level, so that students can be encouraged to establish their own businesses in their hometown. So under these circumstances, what is the Welsh Government encouraging the education sector to promote local entrepreneurship so that our young people don't feel that they have to leave areas such as Pembrokeshire?
Well, I must say that the aim of his party is to cut the skills budget. And of course, we are not going to do that. We have Business Wales, the one-stop shop service to help young people, and yesterday the minister launched a new service to support young people to set up their own businesses over the next 5 years and to assist them in ensuring that the good ideas that they have, that their businesses can employ people.
First Minister, Farai Teig tell me that whilst men and women inquire about business startup grants in approximately equal numbers, far fewer women actually proceed with applications. Now, this implies that we need to have awareness of the particular needs of potential female entrepreneurs. How could the Welsh Government build this into its application process?
Well, 44% of individuals accessing the business startup service are female. But we have the Participation Fund, which aims to help people overcome any barriers that may prevent individuals from taking advantage of support through Business Wales, including access to childcare. I know that business organisations provide direct support and services for women. They include Chwarae Teg, of course. Business Wales does actively hold events specifically for women, providing networking opportunities for women in business. So, whilst it's right to say that the number of inquiries as between men and women was not equal, but the divergence is not that great, it's the next step where support is needed, and a number of actions have been taken in order to close that gap.
Rhina Yarworth.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Entrepreneurs, of course, need to know in considering establishing their own businesses in Wales that the staff are available to help to develop those businesses and that the resources are available to develop skills within their staff. Now, I spoke to one entrepreneur in terms of computer programming this week who told me that once he'd made inquiries, he'd found that there wasn't any specific apprenticeship schemes available in Wales for developing computer programmers. Now, does the First Minister agree with me that if that is the case, then that is unacceptable? And would he agree to look in to the opportunities that do exist in order to develop apprenticeships in this crucial area?
Well, of course, I will write to the member regarding that specific point so that he can answer the question posed to him by the individual. But we have Jobs Growth Wales, of course, which has assisted people with IT skills, and that's been very successful indeed. And on the point that he's just raised, I'll write to him.
Mark Isherwood.
How is the Welsh Government helping to improve the well-being of people in North Wales?
Well, investments support a prosperous and resilient economy in the north, developing important infrastructure and transport opportunities and ensuring the resilience of the natural environment.
When speaking at the Carwyn Connects event in Mull Theatre Clwyd, Cymru, in October, a constituent told you that she was waiting months in pain for pain management treatment, whereas previously she received it in weeks in the Counts of Chester. You replied that you were surprised she was allowed to go to the Countess as cross-border protocol was in place. How will you now respond to that constituent and others like her who says, after waiting so long in pain, I'm very pleased with my treatment, I went privately, I had to empty my savings account?
That wasn't what she said. What she said was that she was being prevented from going to the Countess of Chester Hospital, if I remember rightly, and I expressed surprise at that, because that's why I mentioned the cross-border protocols. So that individual should have received a reply from me anyway, because all people who ask a question get a reply. But to the best of my recollection, it was about not being able to access services at the Countess of Chester, which is the issue that I was I couldn't understand, given the fact that we have those cross-border protocols in place.
Alan Fred Jones.
Thank you. Given the review into maternity services in North Wales, which is currently ongoing, I have a simple question for you. If you were an expectant parent, would you be content if you lived an hour and a half to 2 hours away from a consultant-led maternity unit?
Well, the situation now, of course, is that we know that a decision has been made. There will be still three maternity units in North Wales because of what we did. As a government, we took Betsy Cadwaladr into special measures, and because of that and the work done by ministers, there is staff now that will ensure that that maternity unit will still continue.
Aled Roberts.
First Minister, the maternity units will remain in place until the regional unit is opened in Glanclwyd. The report submitted to the Health Board today, as they receive the business case for the regional centre, says that they accept a report by the Royal College of Gynaecologists in January, and after that they will need to go out to further consultation on the situation post 2018. So in order for us to have some assurance in terms of the centres in Bangor and in Wrexham, do you expect the Health Board to consult further post-January and before the Assembly elections on the ongoing situation post-2018?
Well, not post-2018, but we will expect them to consult before any changes, naturally, but I don't think that there is any cause for postponing the Cernic itself. That will go to Glanclwyd and they're supportive of that. The choice was between Glanclwyd and Arrow Park. They didn't wish to see the babies in greatest need going to Arrow Park, and so the Cernic is going to Glanclwyd. But of course any changes ultimately will be consulted upon.
Question six, Gwenda Thomas.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Will the First Minister make a statement on the provision of training for disabled people?
Thank you. A key priority remains to progress young people and adults into employment at the earliest opportunity, and all programmes that support unemployed individuals through the Welsh Government are open to everyone irrespective of their personal circumstances to ensure equality of opportunity.
Thank you for that, First Minister. Neath Petorbos Council's Pan Disability Project, Bespoke Enterprises, held its first Christmas fair recently and sold various festive gifts made by the Council's Training and Employment Project for people with disability and mental health issues. The project aims to give people the chance to diversify their skills and attain accredited qualifications, recognising their practical experiences. First Minister, do you agree with me that this excellent example of improving outcomes and lives is worthy of praise?
Yes, I do, and I very much congratulate the work the Council has done. I think it can be an exemplar for the rest of Wales, and I thank the Member for raising it.
Mohamed Asker.
Presiding Officer, First Minister, statistics suggest the employment rate for people with disabilities in general is 48%, but around 7% for people with learning difficulties and 15% for people with autism. Learning Disability Wales has said that people with learning disabilities and people with ASD are not accessing the skill training provision offered through the Welsh Government. What plan does the Welsh Government have to review the effectiveness of its programs to support people with learning disabilities and ASD into employment here in Wales?
Well, we look, of course, to ensure that people are aware of the support that's available. I can say that all work-based learning providers delivering certain of the programmes can claim additional learning support funding to assist them with the cost of securing support necessary to make provision accessible to learners with learning difficulties and or disabilities. That's an important route of to employment for many, many people.
Christine Chapman.
Thank you. First Minister, I recently met with a disabled constituent who told me about the difficulties he is experiencing in attempting to find suitable employment opportunities. Now, we know that disabled people have an enormous contribution to make. So how is the Welsh Government engaging with employers to encourage and incentivise them to recruit disabled people?
Well, we are in the process of developing the replacement programme for Work Ready, Skills for Employment Wales, during the consultation phase. For example, we met with a number of representatives from several groups representing disabled people to understand the issues that they raised in order to make sure that our work-based learning offer is as accessible as possible to the people that they represent. And the new programme will aim to address the issues that they raised there to make it easier.
Question seven, Ellen Jones. Will the First Minister provide an update on the progress of the initial scoping study on the Aberystwyth-Carmarthen Railway?
Well, we have now actually received the scoping report and considering the next steps.
Thank you, First Minister. I'm pleased that you've received that report. May I therefore ask you to publish that report?
Well, there's no reason why that shouldn't happen. The report will now be considered by the government, but I can't see any reason in principle why that scoping report cannot be made public.
Burns.
Thank you, Deputy.
Deputy Presiding Officer. First Minister, in the scoping document, I wondered if you'd had, if the organisation that undertook it had the opportunity to, first of all, also look at all the other alternative transport routes, because I'm not sure if you would be aware, but they've now stopped the bus services between Carmarthen and Aberystwyth. So the importance of that line is becoming more and more... sorry.
But one person's asked a question, and you need to finish.
Let me clarify. They are stopping the bus services from my part of Carmarthen to get the ease of Aberystwyth. They are at very inconvenient times. They cannot get to them. That's the first point. The second point, First Minister, there are a lot of students who need to travel that route, and they are struggling to get to Aberystwyth. So I wondered if, again, the scoping organisation had had the opportunity to talk to to the Education
Quickly,
Minister
please.
And other interested organisations. Sorry, I've made a mistake.
The Trawscymru service that yes. runs between Aberystwyth and Carmarthen in terms of between Carmarthen and Aberystwyth. We know there are connections to Carmarthen and Aberystwyth railway stations. We know there are connections to the Booker bus service at Lampeter, Pencarrion, Venabach and Aberoeron as well. But this scoping study looked particularly at whether the former railway line could be reopened. We do know from the scoping study that about 3% of the track bed has been lost, either built on or where sections are no longer visible at all. And there would need to be, for example, ways would have to be found around those obstacles were the track to be rebuilt. I think it's fair to say in advance of the publication of the study that it's clear that the reinstatement of the line would be a complex operation and it'll take some time to understand exactly what the costs might be. It's possible to give a fairly global figure, but not a figure with any confidence at this stage, given the fact that more work needs to be done in terms of looking at the detail in the different sections as to how that could be, those sections could be reinstated.
Question 8, William Powell.
Diolch, Hedda Pwylawydd. Will the First Minister please make a statement on mobile phone reception in Mid and West Wales?
Well, telecoms policy is not a devolved matter, of course, but we are working with the UK government, with the mobile industry and Ofcom to secure improvements in mobile coverage across Wales. I did note the UK government announced in 2014 that it has reached a legally binding agreement with the operators so that 90% geographical coverage, I beg your pardon, for 2G, 3G and 4G by 2017.
I'm grateful to the First Minister for that comprehensive response, but last week an RAC Foundation study revealed that after the Highlands and Islands, three of the areas of the local authority areas within the UK that were least well served actually fall within Mid and West Wales, with hundreds of miles of Welsh roads not even having 2G coverage. An astonishing 437 miles in Powys, Gwynedd with 172 and Ceredigion with 156. First Minister, in the context of the impact that that has on public safety, but also in terms of hampering business development, what more can the Welsh Government do to help to persuade the mobile phone industry to commit greater infrastructure investment to actually create a climate which is more positive for business and also enhances public safety?
Well, as I said to the member, coverage is meant to be 90% of Wales by 2017. We will hold the UK Government to its agreement with the network operators. It's also the case that 98% of Wales will be covered by at least one operator. That is what they tell us will be happening by 2017, and clearly we want to see that actually happen.
Keith Davis. Russell George.
First Minister, in recent months there has been some deterioration in mobile coverage in my Montgomeryshire constituency. Now, in a recent meeting, I met with the four mobile operators, and they said that one of the most significant barriers to investment in mobile infrastructure in Wales is restrictive planning policies. Now, they have suggested that changes to the planning framework are required to increase permitted development to a height of 25 metres and to allow 5 metres increase in mast height in non-protected areas. Is this something that you would be willing to discuss with colleagues and consider and bring forward changes to the planning framework?
Well, it's certainly not an issue that's been raised with me in terms of masts. I've certainly had experience of people objecting to masts being put in place, but I'm not aware of operators having problems with general permitted development order and the placing of masts around Wales. If there's evidence of that, of course, we're prepared to look at it.
Simon Thomas.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I understand, of course, that this isn't devolved to you as a government, but it's a cause of concern for me that there are whole villages in this region that have no mobile phone service at all from any provider whatsoever. If you take Llanboidi, for example, which is a village of 2,000 people, where if you stand in the middle of the square in Llanboidi outside the market hall and there is no coverage at all, and many people in a viable community where the Welsh language is still important. Now, if we're going to retain people in these communities, then they have to have a mobile phone service. That's a minimum that we should expect. So what can you ensure to do that this 98% actually reaches all of our communities?
Well, we are going to ensure, of course, that the United Kingdom government delivers on this. Some urban parts of Wales don't have any kind of reception at all. We know, of course, about the situation on Anglesey, where it's relatively flat, but it's very difficult to get any kind of signal in part of that island. There is no geographical reason for that at all. It's a question of investing in the network. And so we are continuing to put pressure on the UK government to ensure that the mobile phone companies do attain the target in 2017.
Hugh Davis.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. What job creation proposals does the Welsh Government have for communities in South Wales Central?
Well, we're supporting the creation and retention of jobs across all parts of Wales by helping businesses to start and grow, whether it's through the Small Business Rate Relief Scheme, whether it's through the growth of the Metro, whether it's Jobs Growth Wales, whether it's the Skills for Employment Wales programme, or whether it's the investment that's been brought into Wales as a result of the hard work that's been done abroad.
Thank you, First Minister, for that answer. The Enterprise Zone in St Athan had very disappointing job creation figures recently, only 7 jobs created there. As someone who actually supports the concept of what's going on at St Athan, this was deeply disappointing news. The Welsh Government, in fairness, have put considerable sums of money over a 10-year period into that area of the Vale of Glamorgan. But I hope you'll share with me my disappointment in only 7 jobs being created. What do you think were the specifics that led to such poor job creation figures, and what hope can you offer that those figures will be better in the future?
There is great potential for St Athan and a great deal of interest from investors. We have invested in the road, of course, in terms of straightening the road by the Aberthaw Cement Works. What would really help the Enterprise Zone of St Athan and Cardiff Airport would be the devolution of long-haul air passenger duty, which he has supported, in fairness to him, and he mentioned that, of course, in the when he gave evidence to the committee. We know that that would have an enormous effect on the economic development both of Roos and of St Athan. We know it would attract long-haul flights in and the maintenance of those flights with it. I've heard arguments put forward that we should accept greater fiscal responsibility as government. We know that will happen with the partial devolution of income tax. Why on earth then does that not apply to long-haul air passenger duty? It's something that would have an enormous difference to the Enterprise Zone.
Question 10, Bethan Jenkins.
What discussions has the First Minister had with the UK Government concerning the restoration of open-cast coal mines in Wales?
Well, the Welsh Government has had a robust dialogue with the UK Government concerning the restoration of open-cast coal mines in Wales.
First Minister, I've heard you and your ministerial colleagues argue that the UK Government should provide funding because of the 10-year restoration holiday allowed by the 1994 Coal Industry Act. But isn't it the case that Celtic Energy was restoring its site during that period, right up until it was bought out by the Walters Group? And since then, it has failed to restore a single site in its stewardship. And isn't it true that this unrealistic appeal for money from Westminster, which your government has put very little effort in behind, despite your robust analysis, I've seen FOIs, and it has come back saying something very different. What is this tough action that you're taking in this regard? Can your government take action as opposed to crying crocodile tears to Westminster?
Well, hang on a second. Is she saying that Welsh taxpayers should pay for a mess created by the UK government in 1992? Because I'm not prepared to accept that. I'll tell you that now. The reality is that much of the problem lies in the fact that the escrow accounts did not contain enough money in 1992 to pay for much of the restoration that's needed now. I'm not prepared to let the UK government get away with that. I am not prepared to accept, for example, that in the Wales Bill, the licensing of open-cast coal mines remains with the UK government. and land restoration is left with us as Welsh Government. I'm not prepared to accept that. The reality is it was the privatisation of coal that left literally holes in the ground across Wales, and I do not accept that the Welsh taxpayer should pay for the restoration of open cast mining when the problem was caused in Whitehall.
Lynn Neagle.
First Minister, I very much welcome the focused review of the MTAN that the Minister for Natural Resources has announced. But this is now a very urgent situation, particularly as there's a new planning application in to Opencast at Vartig Hill, which is identical almost to the previous one, which will mean Opencast right on top of people's homes and a local primary school. What further steps can you take to ensure that this review is taken forward with great urgency, and will you discuss this with the Minister for Natural Resources?
The member, of course, has been a doughty campaigner on this issue in her area, and I know that the Minister is fully aware of her views and the views of the local community. I will write to her with further information on the timetable on an issue that I know is of exceptional importance to her.
Lynn Graham.
First Minister, in that review, it's very important also that proper consideration is given to the restoration of these sites. Would you favour some form of insurance guarantee which can keep pace with inflation?
The difficulty is this, that the money that's set aside in, not every escrow account, but many escrow accounts, is nothing like enough to cover the restoration of the site. If the operator then folds or passes ownership on to an organisation registered elsewhere in the world, then, of course, there is literally nobody to enforce the restoration against. That's the concern that we have. Now, the reason why that situation has arisen, because in 1992, in order to make open cast mining attractive to privatisation, there were limits placed on the amount of money that should be set to one side. Now, it's true to say that in the past, restoration has taken place and land has been used properly. But my the great concern that I have, and I know many of us share this concern, is that as we see the price of coal dropping, as we see demand dropping, that there is a danger that we will literally be left with holes in the ground with not enough money to restore them. I don't think it's fair that the Welsh Government and the Welsh taxpayer should have to pay for the restoration of those sites when it wasn't the Welsh Government or the Welsh taxpayer that actually created the situation of there being not enough money to restore the sites in the first place.
David Rees.
First Minister, you've rightly pointed out the 1994 Act has actually given the UK Government a let-off effectively on the costings of the restoration of the land site in Parkstead in particular. And I know that the head of the Coal Liabilities Unit recently attended a meeting which residents in both your constituency and my constituency attended. Will you chase up the promises that were made in that meeting to the residents to actually come back to them with some answers? But we also have discussions with the Petorba Council to ensure that restoration, if it's enforced, will take place and that the liabilities will be placed and that Celtic Energy don't get themselves out of funding the restoration sites.
Well, a complicated web has been woven around that site. I'm not here to give my view in terms of a constituency issue, but I know most of it lies in his constituency, even though the threat, if I can put it that way, lies to those in my constituency. We do have a situation with Parkslip where there is no apparent owner with assets against which to take action. And we know that there is roughly a quarter of the sum that's needed to restore the site in the escrow account. And that is something that greatly concerns his constituents, as they do mine. The reality is, in my view, that action needs to be taken, and it is it's a matter for the council to consider what action that they take. But ultimately, the great concern that all have in the area is that there will simply be a substantial shortfall in terms of restoring the site if the current owners decide that they are not in a position or unwilling to restore it.
Thank you, First Minister.